It's a long way to the Hollywood Walk of Fame from Waukesha, Wisconsin, but Les Paul was destined to make it. Lester William Paulsfuss was born in 1915, gifted with an ear for music and a flair for inventing. By age 8, this wizard of Waukesha was punching holes in his mother's piano rolls to create new sounds. Soon, playing music became a passion. The young redhead called himself Red Hot Red, and he was, earning a princely $35 a week in 1925. The guitar was his ticket, and he began enhancing it right from the start. He rigged a crude microphone out of telephone parts and jammed a phonograph needle into his guitar to amplify the sound. By his early teens, Les had built a primitive recording machine. Among its parts were dental belts and the flywheel from a Cadillac car. Good fortune came early to Les Paul. While he was still in his teens, he became a hit in country music. But by the mid-1930s, Les left that scene for the love of jazz. He gravitated to Chicago. At 6 a.m. each day, he would play hillbilly music on the radio as Rhubarb Red. Then he would jam with jazz greats like Louis Armstrong and Art Tatum all night long. By the late 1930s and early 40s, Rhubarb Red had become Les Paul, and national fame was his. He played with the big names of popular music: Fred Waring and his Pennsylvanians, Judy Garland, Burns and Allen, Rudy Valley, and his dear friend, Bing Crosby. On Armed Forces Radio, the Les Paul Trio backed talent like the Andrews Sisters, Jack Benny, and Dinah Shore. The mid-1940s also brought Les Paul together with his longtime idol, the great guitarist Django Reinhardt. Behind the scenes, Les had kept inventing all the time. He created disc-to-disc multiples, which allowed him to play along with himself. After recording a rhythm track, Les would play the disc back and add other parts over it, performing live. In a move that would change music forever, Les Paul also designed a series of solid-body electric guitars with pickups to amplify the sound. He made one out of a railroad rail, one called the Clunker, and one whose looks lived up to its name, the Log. He tried to rouse the interest of the Gibson Guitar Company, but they weren't interested in a contraption that looked like a broomstick with pickups. While Gibson wasn't convinced of Les Paul's vision, Bing Crosby was. He urged Les to build his own studio, which was constructed in a soundproof garage in Hollywood. The studio cost the huge sum of $415, but Les captured a sound there that rivaled or exceeded the state of the art. One of the most important people to climb through the studio's window, which was the only entrance since Les had sealed up the door, was a young singer named Colleen Summers. Gene Autry had recommended her when Les needed a singer for some country music shows he had planned for a reprise of Rhubarb Red. Les and Colleen hit it off immediately, personally as well as creatively. He nicknamed her Mary Lou for the country gigs, and they began a relationship that years later would blossom into the famous duo of Les Paul and Mary Ford.
You're welcome as the flowers on the Mockingbird Hill.
While Les had become famous playing pop music with major stars, he knew it was time to change when his mother said there was someone who sounded just like him on the radio. Les quit touring and worked in his studio until he came up with a sound that no one else could copy. After 2 years of experimenting, he emerged with 22 multi-tracked songs on which he'd played every part himself. One of those was the hit, Lover. The Les Paul sound was bright, big, and unmistakable. He made his own pickups for his guitars and achieved a signature sound that's never been duplicated. The public fell in love with the new sound of Les Paul. He had signed a recording contract with a fledgling company called Capitol Records, and by 1948 had begun a golden decade of hits, which helped Capitol become a major record label. That success could have ended almost right away. A serious car accident left Les in a cast from his waist to his neck and nearly cost him his right arm. During almost 2 years of convalescence, Les pondered new inventions and even sketched plans for a prototype synthesizer drawn with his good left arm. At his first comeback show, Les needed an accompanist, so he called his girlfriend, Mary Lou, up from the audience, and she played a little guitar. The crowd loved her, and soon she became a permanent part of the Les Paul Trio. There was just one thing left to do. Les thought Mary needed a stage name that sounded rich. Flipping through a phone book, Les looked up Astor and Rockefeller, but chose the name made famous by Henry Ford. Colleen Mary Lou Summers became Mary Ford. Les may have picked her name, but Mary picked the time and the place for their wedding. In December 1949, at a club in Milwaukee, it was the match of a lifetime.
I hear a song when I think of you. You're gone and the song is blue. Winds call your name, hills echo it too. Leaves whisper, where are you?
Les Paul and Mary Ford hit the big time, winning fans around the world. Their incredible string of hits included How High the Moon, Tiger Rag, The World is Waiting for the Sunrise, I'm Sitting on Top of the World, and Vaya con Dios. Les Paul achieved their unique blend of voices and instruments with an array of technical wizardry. He had a portable sound mixer that he could take on tour. He also had one of the very first reel-to-reel tape machines, which his pal, Bing Crosby, had given him in 1949. He realized he could use one tape machine for sound-on-sound recording, just like he'd done years earlier on disc. But the next half decade, he recorded multiple takes live, overdubbing Mary's voice and his guitar to create a unique sound. With typical humor, he credited his multi-tracking method to a mythical device called a Les Pulverizer.
Dear one, the world is waiting for the sunrise. Every little rosebud is covered.
Les Paul's reputation as an inventor was growing as surely as his star was rising. In 1952, the Gibson Guitar Company introduced his solid body guitar, the Les Paul Standard. For the next several years, Les refined his guitars, which have a style and sound desired by musicians worldwide. Along with his good friend, Leo Fender, Les Paul made the electric guitar an idea that changed music forever. In the 1950s, Les and Mary moved to the New Jersey countryside, where for 7 years they filmed their popular television show, Les Paul and Mary Ford at Home. The show's sponsor, Listerine, built the house so Les and Mary could do the TV show near the company's headquarters. Les turned the home into a state-of-the-art studio complex and has lived and worked there ever since.
Now the hacienda's dark, the town is sleeping. Now the time has come to part, the time for weeping. Vaya con Dios, my darling. Vaya con Dios, my love.
It was there in 1953 that Les Paul hit upon an invention that dramatically changed the music industry, the 8-track recording machine. In concert with the tape machine manufacturer Ampex, his idea soon became a product. By the following decade, 8-track recordings were the standard. But so much success brought tremendous pressure. Mary Ford wanted to retire from performing and be a full-time mother to the couple's 2 children. They divorced in 1964, but remained friends until Mary's death in 1977. Les worked on alone. It's in the genes, he says.
Vaya con Dios, my love.
His attention turned towards inventing until the mid-1970s when Les answered a friend's request to play a jazz gig. The applause lured Les out of retirement and he began touring again, playing jazz joints, the Grand Ole Opry, and major concert halls. He even toured with rock stars who were huge fans of his, including Jeff Beck, John McLaughlin, Albert Collins, and Keith Richards. In 1976, Les Paul reached another milestone, winning a Grammy Award for an album he recorded with Chet Atkins, Chester and Lester. The award brought his Grammy total to 5, including the cherished honor of a Lifetime Achievement Award and a place in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But Les Paul hasn't rested on his laurels. Following a quintuple heart bypass in 1980, Les followed his doctor's orders to work hard. Since 1984, Les and his trio have played 2 shows every Monday night in the New York jazz club, Fat Tuesdays. His gigs have attracted fans of all ages, especially guitarists like Jeff Baxter of Steely Dan and the Doobie Brothers, who joins him in the show you're about to see. So pull up a front row seat and enjoy the sound of a genuine innovator, a man who has influenced the art and science of music like a modern Da Vinci. You'll see that the years haven't dimmed his enthusiasm, and his effortless style still makes great music look easy. Les Paul is truly a living legend of the electric guitar. You won't see his like again.
Don't sigh, don't cry. Thank you.
The story goes like this, Jeff. When I got my first job in Wisconsin, the guitar wasn't loud enough. So I went down and bummed my dad's radio off of him. I had to amplify the guitar. So I took the other half of the telephone, the earpiece, put it underneath the strings and says, Jiminy Christmas, man. If I could stretch this thing out a little longer, I could do it. So I go to the local radio station. I asked the engineer how I could do that, and he showed me, and we're sitting there winding wire and making this thing, put it underneath there, and boy, the tips went up, and I've got my electric guitar going, and I now have a harmonica, a guitar, a PA system, the whole thing. And so the music and the inventing, the creating, the electronics, the whole thing seemed to work together. They were all stepping stones to lead to the guitar. And when I got the guitar, I found that I had something that was better than any, and no offense to you gals out there, but I had something that was a better combination than anything I could possibly dream. I had a psychiatrist, a housewife, I had a mistress, I had a cook. I had everything all in one with something I could wrap around my arms and I could play. And when, no matter how I felt, this was the best bartender in town. And that guitar and I, we just latched on together and we says, we're gonna be buddies for life. Thank you. stunts. I started out in Chicago as a young kid as Rhubarb Red. And by God, I made a hell of a lot more money than I make it down here at Fat Tuesdays. And I was singing those things with the cymbal between my legs and everything. Same thing you're doing, Lou. Same thing you're doing now. Well, the one-man band? Well, I did it. And this is one of my biggest hits. Just cut the S off of that thing and you got it right there. Here's the way it went. There's a hotel in the city and you climb the broken stairs. They serve the hash upon the second floor.
Second floor.
Serve the hash upon the second. There's a graveyard in the cellar. Doctor's office in the parlor, and the undertaker keeps his shop next door. Play a Jimmy Ola run out. Oh, that hotel where I stay, it is turning my head gray. The landlord is always full of beer.
Miller.
That's it. And then if you're going to end this song, you just go, And the mail comes pouring in. You can't believe what I got. Huh? And here I'm down at Fat Tuesday. I was better off with Bing Crosby, for God's sakes.
Well, you know, when you're an innovator, a lot of times people do not want to leave the status quo.
That goes for every record company, guitar company in the world.
Nothing changes, right?
No.
Nothing changes.
The toughest thing in the world is to convince them with something new that this is a great idea. But when I went to Gibson, when I went to them with this idea, they turned it down. They did not believe in it. And if it wasn't for Leo Fender putting out the Fender first, we wouldn't have the Gibson guitar out there, because Gibson immediately said, find that character with the broomstick with the pickups and hire him. And they hired me. And when they signed the contract, it was snowing like mad. We're in Stroudsburg, Pennsylvania. I was with Fred Waring at Shawnee Shawnee on the Delaware. I signed the contract, and the president's standing in the doorway, Gibson. And he said, oh, by the way, he says, before I leave, he says, we have one problem. And he says, I forgot to tell you about it. And I says, what's the problem? And he says, well, we may not want to call this a Gibson. And he says, there's nothing saying what to call this guitar. And I says, well, why don't you call it a Les Paul guitar? He says, would you put that in writing? Thank you. You're down. Mary and I had decided that at the rate we were going, doing five shows a week, like the Sullivan Show, like the Gleason Show, like you name it, okay. Making recordings constantly, playing all the different theaters in the country, being so famous and so, it's such a heavy life. You don't realize it, but you're burning yourself out. And Mary just said, and rightfully so, Mary says, we don't need the money. What are we doing? Why don't we just throw it aside and live and have a good time for the rest of our life? Why are we knocking ourselves out? Anybody that plays a guitar or an instrument that's devoted is selfish. They have to be selfish. They put 8-12 hours in practicing a guitar. You're out jamming at night. You're not living a normal life and so forth and so on. Well, Mary and I weren't living a normal life. So nothing would work unless we both gave up, okay? And I could not give up. So I continue to this day to build, to work, to enjoy myself. My fun is in my work. I enjoy every bit of it. As long as the rest of the people don't mind. As I tell them that at Fat Tuesdays, I says, I'll stay here as long as you can stand it. Found a better person, a better partner, a more talented person than Mary in my whole life. And probably as long as I live, I will never find anybody as talented as that person. And what a great marriage we had. What an Amos and Andy we were. And so I'm very grateful for that. Now, I don't know how the good Lord up there can can find two people and get us together in Hollywood, but we managed to do it, thanks to Gene Autry, okay? He's the guy that told me about Mary. But anyway, just to have that is enough. Thank you. was to retire in 1964.
Why?
Because I was done with it. I was done with music and I was going to do other things.
And you quit playing the guitar?
I never even had a guitar around the house. I just forgot music completely. And all the guitar players were begging me to play the guitar again. So finally one day I says, all right, I'll go out and play. So like 1975, I come back out and start playing the guitar. I figured nobody wants to hear me play the guitar and I can't even play anymore. So this hand has two fingers that I can use. This one has none. So there's no fingers that move in this hand at all. These are all stiff. So I got two fingers to play with. So I'm saying, what in the world do I want to do with two fingers? So I go to the doctor, and the doctor says, can I examine you for the rest of you, you know? So I said, sure. So he examines the rest of me.
Have a look,
yeah. To my amazement, the big problem was not my hands at all, was not the arthritis I had at all. But he says, you have a problem. You need a 5 bypass. I need a 5 what? And of course, at that time, they said, 3 doctors in New York would touch me. And so I went searching for someone that would take a chance on me to do the heart surgery. When they did the heart surgery, and it was successful, I went to my bed, and I'm lying there, and I took a piece of paper, and I drew a line down the center, the negative and the positive, the things I like to do and what I don't like to do. And when I got all done with everything, hands down, it was not the big, large concerts, the famous things of playing for President Roosevelt. These were not important at all. It was playing in a little joint for an intimate group of people. So I just hunted from one joint to another joint to another joint until I says, this is the place I want, right here. And I said, I just want to play for these people that are sitting right in front of me in this nice, cozy little place. This is where I want to spend the rest of my life.
At Fat Tuesday.
At Fat Tuesday. Thank you.
Les Paul, ladies and gentlemen. Les Paul. Les Paul.